Today we're going to look at quite a few examples where I think some fairly dubious science has been affecting agriculture, fishery and forestries. And these are affecting some of the biggest parts of our economy and people who, you know, do the hard work in society. And the areas where I think the science institutions may have been affected by groupthink and basically just a woeful lack of quality assurance systems, even if it's not groupthink. Now, look, I've been arguing about this since well before I was fired from James Cook University for essentially saying that a lot of this science is just untrustworthy because there's not enough quality assurance. Now, in many of these cases, there's environmental regulations that have been slapped on farmers and the like. And perversely, it's not like that you've got a balanced economy with the environment. In many of these, they're actually damaging the economy and also damaging the environment as well. So that makes it even worse. All right, we won't go into much detail in any of them, because I just want to do a broad brush on them. And I'm going to start with perhaps the most ridiculous, but maybe the least important, but it really is ridiculous. And this was the closure of the Gulf of Carpentaria gillnet fishery to save the Great Barrier Reef. Now, look, Australia's a big place. Look at this map. This is where the Gulf of Carpentaria is. This is where the Great Barrier Reef is. You might notice that there's something in between. It's called Cape York Peninsula. It's a very long way. It's about 700 kilometres to the Great Barrier Reef. What science was used to close this fishery? Well, actually, I don't think there was any science. But even if there was, I think it would be a good idea if that was checked, don't you? Because frankly, on the surface of it, this looks nuts. Now, on that general theme, but much broader and, you know, on a much greater scale, the whole reduction in the fish catch in Australia over the last 20 years, which is difficult to get exact numbers of, it depends on how you measure it, but it's easily, it's been cut in half. Australia's gone from a really major exporter to importing about 70% of our seafood. Now, Australia has the third largest area of ocean in the world. Are these reductions based on ideology, or are these are they based on proper science? I think it'd be well worth a major audit of those institutions. All right, now the next one is methane from cattle. Of course, cows produce methane, and that's cooking the climate, we're told, and flooding Bangladesh every time you have a steak. And to be fair, Australia hasn't got yet too much in the way of regulations on methane production from cattle, but it's coming in. So just recently, the Albanese government has introduced legislation where greenhouse gas accounting is going to come in on the large cattle producers. Now, they have to have, at the moment, at least 100 people working for them. So that's just a very few. But you can obviously see those numbers are going to come down. And before you know it, just about every cattle producer is going to have greenhouse accounting, and that's going to cost a whole lot. But look, there's so much of the science here which you can question. Now, the big one for me is, yes, cattle produce methane, and I'm not even going to argue as to whether that produces a huge greenhouse effect. I don't think it does, but that's not my main worry. The fact is that if the cow doesn't eat that grass and produce methane from the microbes in its gut, then a kangaroo is going to eat that grass and produce methane from the microbes in its gut. It's not going to make any difference whether the cow eats it or the kangaroo eats it, or even whether the ants in many cases are eating that. So a lot of the anthills west of here, they're actually little methane sources because they're using microbes to digest that material. So I think that would be an excellent example of where we could do with a little bit of science checking. All right, and it's going to be a big deal soon. Now, something that's already a big deal, and I've been rabbiting on about this forever, is the Great Barrier Reef, the three big things: pesticides, nutrients, fertilizer, and sediment. Are they really killing the Great Barrier Reef? Are all the draconian legislations really necessary? Now, when it comes to pesticides, when you actually measure the pesticides out on the reef, you cannot measure them with even the most sensitive scientific equipment, which means they're not having an effect. The farmers are not having an effect. Well, that's my interpretation of that science. When it comes to sediment and nutrients, well, you've got, you know, 100 times more sediment and nutrients that is cycling automatically around the Great Barrier Reef in an open system than comes down the river. So how can the farmers be having an effect? It's certainly something that worth a proper scientific look at, I think. Now, this is another huge one, an absolutely monstrous one, and that's the Murray Darling and the buybacks of water from irrigators for so-called environmental flows. Now, there's a whole bunch of assumptions with these, and, you know, the reduction in irrigation is, I think, you know, by 20-25%. That's a big deal. The less water you got, the less you can produce. It's just as simple as that. So one of the highly questionable scientific propositions is that the lower lake, Lake Alexandrina, right at the mouth of the Murray, was always fresh, and we've got to keep it fresh by having these bigger environmental flows. And a lot of the so-called scientific institutions will make this claim. But actually, when you look at the information, it's a highly dubious claim. For a start, when Charles Sturt, the first explorer, wandered down the Murray, he reported salt water way up the Murray. A lot of newspaper reports from, you know, the early 1900s will say exactly the same thing. Deep in the sediment, the organisms, the microorganisms that have been buried, you know, the calcareous organisms, a lot of these are marine species. And actually, one of the biggest worries about the lower lake drying out is that you get acid sulfate production from the sediment. Acid sulfate occurs only from marine sediments, well, pretty much only from marine sediments. So good evidence that this is a load of twaddle, and I think it would be well worth a bit of an audit. Before we go on, I want to give a huge thanks to all the channel's supporters. All right, carrying on. The next one is the Mary and Burnett River. Now, I'm coming back to the Great Barrier Reef. I've mentioned this before. They're regarded as Great Barrier Reef catchments, so they must be regulated and restricted in their environmental output because of that, to protect the Great Barrier Reefs, supposedly. But actually, these rivers don't even flow into the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park, and the ocean currents takes anything that comes out of the river away from the Great Barrier Reef. And there is just the little minor point that those ocean currents are big, 300,000 times bigger than the river, and flowing in the wrong direction. Look, these rivers are dropping the ocean as far as the Mary Burnett is concerned. I think that would be a good one to have a little bit of an audit. All right, the next one is, this is an interesting one. The Brisbane River. Why is it not a reef catchment? Why is it that all the people in that big city there who vote green and all the rest of it don't have coral reef restrictions on them? Because actually, there are brilliant reefs just at the mouth of the Brisbane River, the biggest population centre, but they don't get any restrictions. Now, look, I don't actually want them to have restrictions, but you can see that, yes, I'm getting a little bit sort of antsy here, because it seems that the people where the votes are, where it doesn't affect them, they're very happy to put restrictions on the farmers up here, which actually pay for their bacon. Moving on, vegetation management. Now, this is a really big one. And this is one which a lot of people find really surprising when I say some of these things. They think that maybe I've gone completely mad. There is a good case that, well, it's just a statement of fact that there's large parts of Queensland and New South Wales where there are now far more trees now than there were before European settlement. And that's because we've stopped the Aboriginal fire regime. Now, the fires go through, they kill the saplings, and you can go from you can convert a forest to grassland, or you can keep a grassland. If you don't burn grasslands that are close to the forest, they will become forests. So a lot of what you hear about the vegetation clearing in Queensland is actually clearing areas that were cleared before, maybe 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, but have then reforested. But there are lots of other areas where the forest has come in when they were grassland during the Aboriginals period. And because of the lack of burning, they've converted back into forests. And these are native species. Possibly the best example of this, which I love to use, is pretty much the earliest picture of Australia by Captain Cook's artist in Cooktown, where Cook was shipwrecked in the Endeavour River with a big hole in his boat. Behind him there was a hill, and it was called Grassy Hill, and Cook walked up that hill and he looked out over the sea and said, oh my goodness, what am I going to do now? How am I going to get out of the Great Barrier Reef? If Cook went up that hill today, he'd see nothing because it's a rainforest. Grassy Hill has turned into a rainforest, and that's because the Aboriginal burning stopped. And by the way, it was very quick. It happened within about probably 60 to 80 years of Cooktown being settled. And this brings on to me to the whole issue of bushfire management and forestry, right? Every time there's a bushfire, the ABC will say, is climate change? Now, maybe there is a little bit of an effect of it, but it's just the tiny, tiny effect. The biggest problem is that we've changed the Aboriginal fire regime, regular burns. And this is another one of these examples where they often do it, or they claim they do it to protect the koalas. But the catastrophic fires that will now go through a forest, you know, those New South Wales forests, they will cook far more koalas than the cool burns that originally happened. So we're actually going backwards. So, you know, the management of our forests, we're closing down the forestry left, right and centre, is actually doing more damage to the wildlife than leaving them as these unmanaged forests, because the Aboriginals did manage it in their own way. But we're also now importing timber from guess where, probably, you know, some rainforest in Papua New Guinea or Borneo for our hardwood timber. All right, now there's a few others which I'm just going to measure, just throw in for good measure. Just ask the simple questions, are koalas really endangered? I don't think they are. There's lots of places where there are a lot of koalas. We've even got them on our block in the scrub up north of here. Right. Or how's this one? Flying foxes. These are, in some parts of Queensland, a real problem. If they take up their home in a park or somewhere, you can't move them, or it's very hard to move them because they're endangered. Well, they don't look awfully endangered. Now, if they really are endangered, I certainly don't want to do anything to them, but you know, maybe they can be controlled just a little bit. Or here's one, and this will show my chip on my shoulder to the people in the cities who don't know, you know, it's not their fault actually. Are crocodiles actually endangered? And should we be managing them up here in North Queensland, right? You go to the beach here, you could be eaten by a crocodile. You go to a swimming hole, you swim over a crocodile. And yet if a crocodile swims south of Gladstone to where all the southern people are, oh, it has to be removed. Well, is this really fair? Is this based on science? I won't go into it. You'll just think I've got a chip on my shoulder about crocodiles. And here's another one, an interesting one, feral animal control. You know, feral animals are a huge problem. We've in Queensland got this problem with fire ants. They came in, I think, about a decade ago. We've tried to control them. It looks like we've failed. We're spending, you know, tens, maybe hundreds of millions of dollars on this. Should we give up? Or what should we do? Anyway, it's worth a scientific audit, no matter which side of that argument you're on. And I'm actually not sure which side I'm on that. All right, so these are just some examples. You may have examples of yourself. And you've got to remember that this problem of science integrity is in every country on the environmental issues, but it's also in every country on lots of scientific issues, whether it's health, energy, you know, nuclear power. Is it everything you've been told about nuclear power true? Well, actually not. Or even things like what's the best way to teach teachers. So it's time to do something. And I've got to say, we are thinking of cooking something up in the near future. Those people who are, just to conclude, those people who are in the agricultural industries, you're going to have to ask yourself a little question in the near future. If push comes to shove, where will you be if you're needed to support the science checking question?